All right. Welcome everyone. This is the College of Agriculture and Bioresources research seminar series, Advancements in Agricultural Research. And we are very happy today to have Dr. Ian Stavness with us. He is a professor in the Department of Computer Science. And following our theme of digital agriculture that we're on right now, he is going to be talking to us about computational agriculture and the type of research that is conducted in his biological imaging and graphics lab over in the building next to us. So there will be an opportunity at the end for questions. If you want to throw your questions in the chat throughout the talk, that is fine as well, and then we could read them after, or if you want to save your questions to unmute yourself, that is fine as well. And like I said, this is being recorded, and both the slides and the recording
Slides.
will then be put up on the seminar website as well for your viewing. So without further ado, I'm going to hand it over to Dr. Stavness.
Great. Thanks very much, Danielle. Thanks everyone who's joined today, and thanks very much to the College of Agriculture and Bioresources for putting together this seminar series. So it's been really great so far, and I'm glad to contribute to it. So as Danielle mentioned, I'm a professor in computer science. I direct the Biological Imaging and Graphics Lab, and we are located in the historical Thorwaldsen Building. So you can see a picture there, and that's where I am today. And I also want to acknowledge that I live and work on Treaty 6 territory and the homeland of the Métis. In the talk today, I'm interested to give my perspectives on the area of computational agriculture, which I really think is a great opportunity for Saskatchewan. So in the talk today, I'll give kind of an overview or introduction to computational agriculture. And then I'll talk about the kind of two main ingredients that I think are needed to take advantage of this opportunity, which are great people and great data sets. And then I'll finish the talk by talking about some opportunities and ways to interact if you're interested and excited about computational agriculture. So starting with computational agriculture, so what do we mean? In general, we talk about digital agriculture, but computational agriculture, it takes us a little bit further to really think and emphasize the computational aspects of using digital data in agriculture. So not just collecting or keeping track of data in a digital form, but really using it, really computing with it to generate new insights, new predictions, new actionable information that wasn't possible before. And as the name suggests, really, it is a combination of the fields of computer science and agriculture quite broadly. So, I think there's roles for computation across all aspects of agricultural research, agricultural and agricultural sector. And one of the main ideas around computational agriculture is doing things at a large scale, which really does fit with agriculture because, yeah, as everyone knows in Saskatchewan, we do agriculture at a large scale. And I think, we really have an opportunity here to do computation at a large scale with agriculture. And really, the benefits or the potential of computational agriculture really extends across all different physical scales as well. So, we see, if we're looking at the level of individual seeds, we can do computation to phenotype seeds, predict their health or their germination rate. Do things like automatic seed inspection and grading. If we're looking at plants at the scale of individual plants, we're typically doing things like estimating the physical characteristics or the traits of those plants, doing things like disease detection or pathology. This scale is, traditionally would be in the space of plant breeding, of plant science experiments here. So individual plants, small plot experiments, and a really rich environment for doing computation. At the field scales, typically where we think of the kind of benefits of computation landing with our farmers and with our growers. So doing things like predicting crop health, generating prescription management, precision management, or prescriptions for growers. So, you know, the agronomy services is in this kind of scale, looking at crop damage or estimates of crop insurance at the kind of field scale. And of course, this is quite fluid because, you know, nowadays, you know, growers and agronomists are looking at also at the plant scale to try to kind of dial in management at a very fine, fine level. And then if we look even higher at the global scale, you know, we can pull in agricultural data from across the world in order to do things like yield prediction, price forecasting, optimizing logistics of getting inputs where they need to be. Hopefully with this slide, you can kind of just get a sense of the breadth of the opportunity here as we embrace computational agriculture in particular. And I want to just mention that, you know, our emphasis on this opportunity around computational agriculture, I think is in Saskatchewan, is really, you know, was foundational on the Plant Phenotyping and Imaging Research Center, or PERC, which has been an ongoing large-scale research project at the University of Saskatchewan, together with numerous partners over the past 7 years. And one of the things we found, you know, in the second phase, we organized PERC around these four flagships of, you know, breeding and root soil microbiome, deep learning, and then field imaging and phenotyping. And, you know, what we found was, you know, we established really close and deep collaborations across these different disciplines. And in particular, you know, as a computer science researcher, I felt, you know, a great opportunity to join into this field through PERC. So, you know, I'm really, really grateful for that opportunity. I think that PERC has really laid a foundation for these new opportunities in computational agriculture and to continue these deep collaborations that we've established. But why Saskatchewan? You know, why, you know, I'm sort of pitching computational agriculture as, you know, maybe not a unique opportunity to Saskatchewan, but one that I think Saskatchewan is sort of uniquely positioned to grow with. You know, of course, the agricultural part is quite clear, right? You know, we have, you know, we're the center of agriculture in Canada, you know, a long history. College of Agriculture and Bioresources is, you know, such a strong part of the university here. But one thing I wanted to emphasize from sort of my perspective is just how strong the computer science researchers we have here are in agriculture. So I wanted to just point out a few people that I've worked with or that I know that are doing really excellent work. Lingling Jin, who's a relatively new faculty member here in the Department of Computer Science at the University of Saskatchewan. She's an expert in bioinformatics, genomics, but she's really embraced plant imaging and plant phenotyping and is really pushing the boundaries there. And so, you know, she's been a great addition. She was her faculty position was partly supported by PERC. So again, the legacy of PERC is definitely demonstrated in the success that we've had with Dr. Jin. Outside of the University of Saskatchewan, you know, at the University of Regina, there's also lots of excellent work happening in this area of computational agriculture. And I'll mention Abdul Bayas, who's actually an engineer, but, you know, we'll adopt him as a computer scientist because a lot of his research is in data analysis and computing generally. But, you know, great lab, doing excellent work, you know, well integrated with the agricultural sector. I know his group works with a number of companies in Saskatchewan as well. And I also wanted to highlight Jordan Ubbins, who is did his PhD through the PERC project. Real expert in deep learning, has been really pushing the boundaries of deep learning in agriculture. You know, he's worked both on phenomics and imaging and then moved and transitioned to genomics. He recently started a permanent position at the NRC here in Saskatoon. So we're really fortunate to still recruit or to keep him in the ecosystem. And, you know, just doing tremendous work. I'm excited to see how his research group grows there. And I highlight these researchers because I want to make the point that, you know, these are computer science researchers that are working directly in agriculture. This is the focus of their research programs. They're not moonlighting in agriculture. You know, they're not doing, you know, medical research and then at night they have one project in agriculture. But no, these folks have really bought in and are really dedicated to this area of research. So I think that's a real strength that we have. And then looking a little bit more broadly, you know, into our neighboring provinces, we see similar things. So Chris Henry at the University of Manitoba, Farhad Malecki at the University of Calgary. Again, two examples of people that I know and work with, but are really dedicating their research programs to computer science and agriculture. And so I think, you know, I think it's really great. And I think that we want to grow this field and there's opportunity to do that. Another reason why computational agriculture is, you know, has such potential in Saskatchewan is because of the large number of innovative companies we have in the space in Saskatchewan. I wanted to mention three in particular that I've worked with. So Precision AI, a startup company out of Regina working on drone-based selective spray and precision agriculture. Really exciting and a great company to work with, and you know, really embodying this idea of computational agriculture in the startup space here in Saskatchewan. And then Nutrien Ag Solutions, which is a breeding company and a service provider, as well as Nuseed Canada, a breeding company that we work with, you know, really doing innovative things. They've really recognized the importance of computation within the processes and within their internal procedures, and embraced it, supported it, and you know, we're really thankful for these types of companies that are doing innovative work. And then I wanted to mention, you know, more broadly, the tech sector in Saskatchewan. You know, certainly the ag sector is very well established here. But we also have grown over the last, you know, 20, 25 years, a very strong general tech sector in Saskatchewan. So I'm thinking in Saskatoon in particular, companies like Siemens, Cali, and Dragonfly. And, you know, this ecosystem of tech companies has been critical for expanding computer science. I think it's one of the main reasons that we've been able to grow computer science here in Saskatchewan, and had and made opportunities for our graduates local here so that they could have a tech career in Saskatchewan, as opposed to having to move to Toronto or Vancouver or the United States. And I do want to, you know, mention that, you know, this ecosystem is well supported by the province, and in particular the Ag Tech Growth Fund. I think on the industry side, I think it's been an important support. But what do we need? So, you know, we have great opportunity here. We've got lots of great companies, great researchers. So if we really want to push forward and grow computational agriculture, what are the things that we need? And I'd argue there's really two main things that we need. We need great people and we need great data. And so I'll focus on these two kind of ingredients here in the talk today. So moving on to people. So we need talented people. You know, I would say that highly qualified, highly trained and qualified individuals and teams are really, to me, the most important factor in project success. You know, certainly on the research side for a research project, I would absolutely say that's the case in my experience. But I think that's quite a broad statement that many people would agree with, or at least have experience with. And so if we look at computational agriculture in particular, we need talented people, you know, in a very particular way, or some very particular attributes. And we can think of these as sort of as a combination of both specialized skills and general skills. Our focus of the computational agriculture program that we're initiating here is the intersection of computer science and plant science. That's a bit maybe a narrow focus, but let's, as an example, those would be, you know, specialized skills where you need to bring multiple disciplines together and really have people that know both sides of the coin. But you could think of it similarly in, you know, computer science and soil science, or computer science and agricultural economics, for example. You know, I think there's in each of the subdisciplines, there's a great intersection of specialized skills that are needed, as well as a set of general skills. So communication being absolutely foundational, particularly in these interdisciplinary and cross-disciplinary areas. You know, computer science and plant science have different languages entirely. And, you know, just bridging that language gap and appreciating and understanding the differences in terminology and in processes and ways of researching or developing are important. And then particularly in computational agriculture as well, since there's an emphasis on data, you know, data management, intellectual property, there's a number of considerations that, you know, skills that are really important for the type of people we need in this area. And not just people, we need teams. And I would say, I like the term deadly teams. You know, we want excellent teams. We need teams of individuals that can move fast and can slay really hard problems. And so we've experienced this in PERC. You know, we've had 7 years where we've trained a lot of students. We've brought a lot of teams together. And I would say, you know, the deadly teams, the best ones, we can see there's a few characteristics of them that are important. So I think the best teams that we found were the ones that were diverse and open. So diverse in terms of perspective, background, but the openness is also important. The sort of willingness to put yourself out there, to talk openly about your ideas and not be afraid, you know, in the sort of team setting, to be open about ideas and trying things out, being bold. We have found, some of the best teams really did match up grad students from different disciplines. So again, I'll emphasize comp sci and plant science. And, where we had teams where we had an awesome computer science grad student matched up with an awesome plant science student, and they really gelled together, we had super great results, really fantastic. So it was, those were the most exciting teams to watch. And there was a couple of characteristics, the enthusiasm was critical, especially from the computer science side, those students that got really enthusiastic about problems in agriculture or problems in plant science or problems in soil science, those are the ones that really excelled. But you also have to be okay with being uncomfortable. When you put these teams together, there's definitely a certain amount of, moving outside of your comfort zone. And those individuals and teams that were sort of open to moving out of their comfort zone, I think the ones that were most successful. And as an example, I wanted to highlight one team and one project in PERC that had these characteristics. And this is the canola counter team. So I'll start with the team. This is a duo, Eric Andvag, master's student in computer science, and Kaylee Chris, a master's student in plant sciences. And these two came together to work on this general problem of canola emergence and trying to estimate it from images. And they built together this really awesome tool called the canola counter. And not only are these are two outstanding individuals, like both Eric and Kaylee, really, really fantastic individuals, but they worked so well together and they had those characteristics that made them, much stronger together, and were really able to accomplish a really, really fantastic project in a very short period of time. So just briefly to kind of show off or give you an idea of the canola counter tool. So this is a screenshot of the web application. Again, it's designed to identify or detect canola seedlings and count them up to get a sense of, to get a measurement of emergence rates or stand counts from early season canola images. And, when you see this application, you think, okay, there's software that's been developed. And yes, absolutely, Eric wrote the software for the tool because he's a computer science student. But absolutely, this tool itself, the contributions from Kaylee were just as important as the software that Eric wrote. I think the result of this project is this, it comes from this tightly cohesive team. And, the canola counter has a very typical kind of workflow for these sort of applications. Upload some images, in this case, you've got to be individual images or a large orthomosaic of a field. Annotate, train, apply models, test them out, retrain them, fine tune them, all those sort of machine learning features are there, try different models, and then inspect the results and, get the results out or visualize them in some way. But, although this is a standard workflow, each step of the workflow and all the details of how it works together, did come from deep discussions between Eric and Kaylee going back and forth about, what could be useful and how things should be presented and what features are needed. So again, it's the result of this really deep collaboration. And this is also shown in the visualizations as well. So in addition to just a spreadsheet of outputs, you can define regions of interest, you can get vegetation coverage in addition to plant counts. You can get estimates of plant spacing by looking at how separated the plants are and large scale density maps over whole fields. And these visualizations in particular came from discussions between Eric and Kaylee about what would be most useful, how can we get these results in a way that match with what the plant scientists need. So again, my absolute kudos to both Eric and Kaylee. Eric is on a rotation at Agriculture Canada right now. Kaylee has a teaching position at Lakeland College. And, couldn't be happier for them. Watch these two, because there's going to be, lots of great things coming out of them. But really, it's this, they're the inspiration, this team and many others were the inspiration for developing a training program in computational agriculture. And the other thing that's really important about the training is that, we want that Saskatchewan experience. Both, we think it's important to train for the needs of the Saskatchewan agriculture sector, but we also know that trainees that come here really come here for that experience. So they want to experience different aspects of the agriculture sector at scale, and they come to Saskatchewan to do that. And of course, in the culture of agriculture, you know, that's been a very, very long-standing, you know, and well-known thing. But now we're starting to see in computer science and some of our other areas across the university of people, you know, joining computer science, for example, in order to work in the field of computational agriculture and coming to Saskatchewan for that. Another aspect of training that's important is emphasizing about hands-on experience. So we want to make sure that computer science students in this area get out in the field, have that direct experience of agriculture, by being out there, seeing, touching, observing different crops, different experimental fields, different production fields for growers. And that's an absolutely unique experience that they can have in Saskatchewan, and a really critical one. And then on the flip side, for the plant science students, we need them hands-on in the cloud, working with data, understanding data science techniques, picking the best analysis tool for their data set. And so that kind of hands-on experience on the, it's less hands-on because it's digital, but that same sort of hands-on experience is important from both sides. And the ultimate goal is really to accelerate careers, across academics, government, industry in the area of computational agriculture for these trainees. So to realize this, this sort of training approach, we proposed an NSERC CREATE, which was successful in the area of computational agriculture. So CREATE is a funding program from NSERC that stands for Collaborative Research and Training Experience. It's really a training program for graduate students. The objective of the program is to train graduate students at this intersection of computer science and plant science. And it's a five-year project, so we're just starting up this training program this year, recruiting the first set of students, but this is a long-term project. So we're excited for the ability to sustain this training program and generate this sort of pipeline of highly qualified individuals for Saskatchewan agriculture over the next 5 or 6 years. As part of the training program, we're establishing a new graduate course joint between computer science and the Department of Plant Sciences in computational agriculture. The critical point of the course is the cross-training. So getting plant science students sort of trained up, not just up to speed, but even to the state of the art of and pushing the state of the art of data science and data analysis. And then likewise for the computer science students, cross-training them so they understand the biological aspects, the agricultural aspects, the terms, terminology, and really get a sense of where the interesting problems are, where the important problems are, and what's needed from from agronomists, from growers, from plant scientists, from breeders. Where are the real needs? Where are the important computational problems? So the cross-training is an important component. The team projects is structured into the graduate course. Just because we knew this, we found this team formation being so critical. So students will do team projects throughout the course. Those projects could be proposed by academics. They could also be proposed by companies or folks in government. So that's an area where I would invite, if you're interested, contact us with the project ideas. And again, it's over the next number of years. So there's lots of opportunity to delve into new team projects. And then, there'll be experiential components as well. So the field days, the cloud days of, getting into the computer lab to look at data and work on data. And then also, tours of the facilities and labs around the province as well, both research labs, but also industry facilities, getting these trainings out, networking with ag companies, with tech companies, and getting a good sense of what the landscape is so that they can pick their career trajectory. We'll be hosting workshops as part of the CREATE program as well. We've identified a couple areas in particular that we think are important. So looking at intellectual property training, we think that's something that's still not really done well at the university. Our students come out without formal training around copyright, patents, of course, but other areas of intellectual property, copyright and trade secrets. And so providing that training, I think, is important as the students go out into industry, but even working in academics or in government as well. And then also managing agricultural data. You know, one of the unique aspects and one of the exciting aspects of computational agriculture is that the data types are so diverse. You know, there's such a range from genomics data to, you know, numerical data of generated by farm machinery or from experiments, imaging data now as we're taking images of crops and fields and plants. So, you know, I think we really do span the whole spectrum of data types. And so managing those can be challenging, and I think we'll have dedicated training in that area. And then trainees will also undertake professional rotations or company internships. So the idea here is that they get out of their home research lab and out into a different environment. So it could be another research lab in a different discipline, it could be a government lab, it could be a company. The rotation is intended to be kind of a short-term activity to give them that experience and develop their professional skills. And then they would also have the opportunity to undertake longer-term internships with companies if we find a good match with some of our partner ed companies. So this is another way that folks in the industry can engage with trainees early is through hiring them on internships. And we're hoping that this dedicated training program will mean that interns that come into our ag companies, whether they're traditional or ag tech companies, that these trainees will be sort of up to speed. They'll be really useful to your organization on day one of an internship. So you know, I think lots of exciting opportunities for the trainees through this program. I wanted to highlight the folks that are on the team here at the University of Saskatchewan on this CREATE team. So we have a really excellent set of researchers in areas of focus in crop breeding and in agronomy, in plant sciences. And then on the computer science side, in areas of deep learning, bioinformatics, imaging and visualization. And you know, this is just a snapshot of the core team. We have a number of collaborators across, you know, in engineering and other colleges, in ag economics. They're all, you know, rounding out this team. And so if you're a trainee that's interested in the program, you know, we have, you know, many aspects covered. So you absolutely will be able to find, you know, the right combination of supervisor or co-supervisors to form a really interesting project in computational agriculture. And then just from this group, I wanted to highlight some of the early career or new members to the university, because, you know, some of us like Curtis, Kirsten, Steve, Mark and Carl, we're kind of old. So we've been around, you know, we're very well known, I think. But, you know, we have great new breeders that just joined the CDC and the university, and Adam Carter and Anna Vargas. We have Maurice Bogot, who is the WGRF Integrated Agronomy Chair, who joined, I think, in 2020 at the university. And, you know, we're really excited to have her and her perspective. You know, her position also has a substantial outreach contribution. So I think that outreach to agronomy industry and to growers, you know, we're really, really excited about her expertise there. And then in computer science, new faculty members, brand new faculty member, Mergank Roshan, who is an expert in computer vision and deep learning. And then Lin-Ying Jin, who I mentioned previously, as our newest bioinformatics prof. So we are really excited about the team and excited about the breadth of areas that we cover in computational agriculture. And I wanted to mention two of our really core and key partners. So one key partner on the CREATE is the Global Institute of Food Security at the University of Saskatchewan. GIFS has been a strong supporter. Of course, GIFS managed the PERC as well. So, you know, we've had a close relationship with GIFS for the number of years in this area. And one of the things that I was really struck by GIFS is that they understood and they appreciate the need for establishing a talent pipeline in this space. And so they've been very supportive. And we envision, you know, students rotating through GIFS to get experience with their platforms and projects. And GIFS will contribute to and help with the workshops and some of the training components as well, particularly that connection to the industry, ag industry in Saskatchewan, since they have this kind of bridge between academics and industry very nicely. And then Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada is also a core, a key partner. And in particular, the research centers in Saskatoon, Lethbridge, Brandon, and Morden. So this we see, you know, definitely as places where students can rotate through to get experience outside of the university. So get a chance. And of course, Ag Canada, AFFC has been a core partner in PERC as well. So, you know, we've seen them, we're working with them, and this is a natural extension to solidify the training opportunities. And I just wanted to highlight one of the past projects that we did collaborate with Ag Canada on in the space, developing a low cost imaging system for crop imaging. It's called the ProTractor. Pro in because we're attaching GoPro cameras to existing farm equipment. In this case, a sprayer boom that was repurposed from one of the Ag Canada sheds. And then, you know, as the machinery moves through the field, we just continually collect images. And so in terms of the research fields, you know, this is a nursery example where each row is a different experimental plot. But these are the types of really detailed information we can get for quite cheap because, you know, the consumer cameras are very inexpensive. There is a bit of post-processing that needs to be done. You know, if you have each row is the experimental plot in this case. So the row appears multiple times in each image. So we have to do a bit of work to kind of pick up unique rows. But once we've done that, then we get actually multiple pictures of each row of canola in this experiment. You can see hopefully the pictures are kind of jiggling a little bit, and that's because we're just looping through each of the different pictures. So they have a slightly different perspective as the tractor moves over them. And then, you know, once we sort of process the data and then we can analyze each individual row, we also are developing software to try to present those or visualize those results back to the plant scientists or the breeders in this case, or tools to help make it easier to process those. So one tool is called the plot reel, where you can kind of click through this stream to identify plots of interest and kind of speeds up some of the annotation aspects. And then also tools to visualize the data once it's been processed. So this is a visualization tool developed by Carl Gutwin's group that takes one of the basic tenets of visualization. So providing detail in context. So the lower panel provides really detailed pictures of individual plants. The middle panel shows where that zoomed in view is in the context of the entire row. And then the top panel shows that row in the context of the whole range. And so we're, again, trying to present this information back to breeders in a way that is maybe more familiar to them or is in a way that is things they want to do. You know, if they want to compare plots within a range, then, you know, we want to be able to provide them that visualization so they don't have to click back and forth in a file folder, for example. And this is just showing the progression of this data over the growing season. So you can see the, you know, plants maturing and flowering. So that's the people side of things. The data is also really critical. So why do we have this emphasis on data? Well, many of the computational agricultural tools are machine learning based. So whether you're detecting seedlings on the left or maybe predicting the density of wheat heads on the right, we want those models to work everywhere. So we want them to work just as well for farms at Herschel, Saskatchewan, as they do for farms in Latin and Saskatchewan. And even beyond that, you know, in other parts of Canada, across the world. And one of the main ways to do that is to generate large data sets with sufficient diversity to capture those different conditions. So we do need large scale data sets. If we look to computer science in general, you know, we have lots of big data sets for general scenes. So this is the Google Open Image data set, one of the V7, one of the latest ones, with 9 million images. And not just the images, but annotations. So people have gone in and denoted what is in the image. So 15 million boxes where people have drawn boxes around something and said, oh, that's a teapot. And even more impressive are the segmentation masks. And these are more detailed annotations, like the ostrich there, where someone's drawn a very detailed outline of an object. And that's pretty critical for things like weed detection or plants where you have overlapping and including leaves. You want to really get fine details of where plants are. And so we're looking at 3 million segmentation masks in this data set on very large number of classes. So if you contrast this open kind of general data sets to what many of our plant data sets are, you know, we have thousands of images and we might only have one class where we've just annotated the wheat heads. And so you can see there's quite a disparity here. But despite the disparity in the data sets, we use some of the same deep learning techniques for both of them. And so there, you know, what we think is important is to expand our plant data sets and make them larger scale and more diverse. We've done some work in this area internationally through the Global Wheat Head Data Set Initiative, which we were one of the founding members. And this, you know, organized a number of research institutes to contribute wheat pictures of wheat heads into this large data set. Here's some examples. You can see just how much diversity and difference there are from different parts of the world, from wheat in Asia versus Saskatchewan, or Europe is the other pictures there. And in conjunction with this data set, we also ran two machine learning competitions. This is where people compete to try to do the best job at detecting wheat heads. And these, you know, I think the main benefit from these competitions was to raise the profile of agricultural problems in machine learning. So, you know, we had over 2,000 people participate in the Kaggle competition, and probably many of those people had never ever seen a wheat plant before, right? They're just computer scientists or data scientists, and we got them working on wheat, which I think was really cool. This wheat data set was then also contributed to a larger data set called the Wilds data set that looks at a whole bunch of different things, you know, pictures of animals, cells, text data, some molecular data, and really to as a test bed for developing new computer science techniques to handle this problem of distribution shift, where you train on one area and you want to test or get it to work in some place that's a bit different. And, you know, this Wild paper, the Wild data set and paper have been, you know, really taken off. So we have over 1,000 citations since 2021. So, you know, if you do contribute, we are able to pull together these things, like large data sets of plants and agricultural data sets, you know, it can have a huge impact very quickly. So that's why we're quite excited about data sets. Of course, the global wheat head data set, there's new, you know, we have the third iteration is coming where we're doing more detailed annotations and starting to move into disease data sets as well. So we're still contributing there. But Saskatchewan is collecting data. You know, if you've attended the seminar series, Scott Noble, Steve Shurtleff have talked, you know, they're the main data collectors here. And Lingling Jin is working on, you know, smartphone-based data collection in greenhouses and controlled environments. So we're collecting a lot of data. You know, companies in Saskatchewan are collecting data. You know, Ag Canada is collecting data. But I do think what we need is some sort of strategy for coming together and cooperating around these data sets. And I've left this slide blank because I do think it's quite a blank slate. You know, I have some ideas for, I think, what's important. You know, do you think it needs to be a government, industry, and academic partnership to form the strategy and to execute on it? And I'm absolutely, you know, very happy to have those discussions. So if you're interested, please do talk to me. Because I think this is, you know, really critical for Saskatchewan. And in particular, you know, for growers or farmers, you know, we need farm data. It's, you know, really critical to be able to make these computational agricultural tools useful for growers. But we know there's some problem, you know, many challenges with this. You know, we know that farm data is private data. You know, it reveals the operations of a farm and finances, you know, the competitive advantage. So we need to ensure privacy, ensure that data is used as it's intended. And we want to make sure that the benefits flow back to those data generators, back to the growers and farmers. There is a real cost to storing, updating, utilizing data, and we want to reduce those costs. And I think this cooperative approach can help to reduce costs. And I think it'll help to elevate the entire ag tech sector. A few just other thoughts on data sharing and data strategy in general. You know, one approach is sort of the trusted entity approach. This has been successful in Manitoba. There's an institute called EMILY, a sort of machine learning focused institute that has a data initiative in, you know, related to ag data, which has been successful. I think in Saskatchewan, an organization like GIFS can play that role of a trusted entity or is well positioned to play that role. So I think we have, you know, institutions that can help with the data strategy that are ready to help with that. And then, of course, on the computer science side, there are new approaches that help to preserve privacy or to not require trust, you know, trustless approaches. One example of this is federated learning, where there is a central model, but the data that's used to train that model stays with all of the individual clients that are accessing it. So there's no private data is not revealed, but there's sort of an exchange of information such that you can train and get a better machine learning model from information across all the clients. And then all of the clients benefit by having access to that more accurate or better model. So interested in those other aspects of data sharing as well, those sort of more technical aspects. And then I did want to sneak in one extra thing. I know I just said people and data, but another really important ingredient is compute or compute infrastructure. Having, you know, very large scale computer servers that can train and deploy these sort of machine learning models. So we need large scale compute. You know, these, you know, they're not very interesting to look at, these large black boxes of computers. But this is the foundation for doing this sort of computational agriculture analysis. And I want to just briefly contrast, you know, the approach in the US versus Canada, because I think it's quite striking. You know, in the US, we saw an executive order from the president in end of October with a strategy for AI to respond to kind of the influx of AI and concerns. And part of that executive order deals with this idea of computational resources, the fact that, you know, right now industry players, private companies have access or have built up very large computational resources, and the public sphere has a deficit of those. And so from October, we saw that executive order. Just last week, we have the pilot project at the NSF already rolled out for national artificial intelligence research resources. So for building new public sphere computation infrastructure. Unfortunately, we don't see that speed in Canada. So the Digital Research Alliance of Canada, which is the rebranded Compute Canada, you know, this, their update is they're still reviewing and prioritizing for funding opportunities. And, you know, I know the people at the Digital Research Alliance are working hard to do this, but we definitely need to accelerate. You know, if we want to be competitive, we need large scale compute to match with our people and our data sets. But back to the positive story, there is lots of great opportunities. So for the CREATE, we're recruiting students right now. Please contact me, or you can go to the website if you're a graduate student or an undergraduate student who's interested in this program. And then, you know, there's a number of interesting research directions that my group is particularly interested in. So in collaboration with Steve Shirtliff's lab, who presented the webinar last week, you know, we are really interested in large scale crop imaging and analysis. And, you know, we think that that this is the way to bring, you know, a lot of the techniques we've done for researchers and small scale into the large scale through these large scale imaging approaches with satellites. We also have a new imaging system at USASC that's actually the PI is Phil McLaughlin in biology, and he's using this to capture pictures of the northern boreal forest to detect wildlife, to count caribou and wolves and moose. But this is a great intermediate scale between drones and satellites, where you get high res but at very large scale. And so this is a unique imaging system we're hoping to leverage for crop imaging as well. There's some great and interesting work in computer graphics on 3D encoding of structures such as plants. So they're really cutting edge and really exciting things. This looks like a video of someone moving around a plant, but it's actually a rendering taken just from a few still pictures around the plant. So really, really cool things. So far they've been used mostly just for graphics, for this kind of rendering, so you can, you know, see the 3D scene. But we're hoping to see if, you know, what's being encoded in here, the 3D structure, we can relate to 3D architecture and plants, and hopefully inform breeder selections and decisions. And then I think there's also, you know, a rich area of plant and crop digital twins. This is an example of a 3D model of a canola plant that was developed by Mick Cieslak at the University of Calgary, one of the research associates on PERC over the last number of years. And so this is a digital model that they grow virtually of canola, and they can vary the parameters to get lots of variation in different canola architectures. And digital twins are very, very popular now in manufacturing and in food processing as well, to have a digital version of your physical manufacturing plant to optimize things. And we really do hope that, you know, the same sort of approaches but applied to biological systems will see some big advantages that will impact plant breeding and plant pathology. So to summarize, hopefully I've argued well that, you know, if we do train the right people and get these highly qualified personnel and combine that with rich agricultural data sets that we've collected in Saskatchewan, that we'll continue this growth of agriculture in Saskatchewan, in particular, this area where we're combining computer science and technology with agriculture. And we are recruiting students, undergrad, master's, PhD students right now. We have a new accelerated master's program in computer science. So if you're an undergrad in computer science, definitely contact us because there's a way that you can jump into a master's program kind of while you're, you know, while you're still in your BSc and participate in this CREATE. And again, I'll leave my contact information there. So if you're interested in collaborating or discussing the data strategy, please do reach out. And with that, I'll leave it there. And then if there are some questions, I'd be happy to take them. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Ian. So we definitely have time for questions. If you want to pop your questions into the chat, or if you just want to unmute yourself and ask, I invite you to go ahead right now. Maybe while we're just giving it a couple minutes, I have a question, Ian. What's the opportunity like right now for interacting specifically with industry and with private companies on research and development? Does most of the proprietary research stay sort of in the university environment? Is there work with private companies where that knowledge or technology generated would then not be made available to the public? How does that work?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question. You know, I think there are, you know, a number of programs and ways that universities interact with companies. You know, the one that we're emphasizing in the CREATE program is the opportunity for trainees to work as interns in companies. You know, we think there's the main benefit there is that, you know, companies can recruit early. I think that's one main strategy for hiring interns. And then certainly the benefits for the trainees are very apparent because they get, you know, that industry experience. They get to potentially try out different areas of industry and see what they sort of what fits best with them. And then, you know, certainly there is intellectual property that needs to be kind of managed, and that data sharing and those relationships that need to be managed. It depends on the program. But you know, we've had, you know, really successful projects where we've been able to navigate those challenges. I will say that the Global Institute for Food Security, GIFS, is really well positioned to help be that bridge as well. That's kind of how they've set themselves up in the ecosystem to try to make some of those interactions easier and smoother and faster. So we also, you know, definitely look to them and appreciate their input into the space as well.
Yeah, great. Thanks. All right, any questions from the audience? Everyone is in stunned silence.
Okay, great. Well, anyway, thanks very much for attending. And, you know, again, please do reach out if you're interested in the CREATE program or these this area more broadly. And thanks again to the College of Ag and Bioresources for this opportunity.
Yes, thank you so much, Ian, for taking the time to talk to us today. We really appreciate it. And everyone, I hope you'll join us next week. We have Derek Peek. He's going to be talking to us about his research. So please do come back. And don't hesitate to reach out to either Ian or myself if you have any questions. I can pass those along. All right. Thank you so much. Take care, everyone.